Hey guys, my name is David Kwon, and welcome to an Hour of Kwonmunism number 4. And this is a series in which I get in front of my MacBook camera, I wear a tie, because I think it's pretty cool, and I talk about an hour about anything really, any different sort of topics. This series has so far been fairly serious. I talk about news events that happen in America, in the world, interesting, thought-provoking topics. Was it last video I talked about the patenting of the human genes? So definitely serious topics I mentioned here. Things I read, books I read, video games I played. Any topic is really up for grabs. And usually the very last part of an hour of communism, I finish with something personal. A personal experience that I would like to share at the very end. So that's something I'm doing. I'm planning it to be a weekly thing. Every week, I want to do an hour of communism and upload it. As long as I'm not too busy, or which I don't imagine I will be for a long time, until maybe August of this year, I probably will not be busy at all. So that's not going to be a good excuse. Or as long as I'm not too lazy, I'm going to upload these every week, and it's going to be uploaded in parts. So I myself will be talking in front of the camera for an hour, but I will be uploading them in like chunks, so it's not an entire hour that's uploaded on there, which I think makes the most sense. The beginning of every video, because it's a weekly thing, every Saturday, I'm hoping it to be Saturday. If I can't do it Saturday, then Friday. Every Saturday or Friday, I'll be uploading an hour of communism. And in the beginning of every hour of communism, I will be kind of recapping what happened on my YouTube channel, specifically the comments that I received. I don't receive too many comments, and I always usually respond to any comments that I find interesting or that get a rise out of me. I usually comment back on the YouTube comment section, but I think it's also good to kind of just go back and highlight those comments in video form. I typed up a bunch of, I copied and pasted a bunch of the comments I received, and I will be reading them aloud in this video. And this video will be probably the only video out of our communism number 4 that I'll edit so that those comments can be seen right on the screen, and you guys can read along with what I'm reading aloud. So this week on my YouTube channel, I didn't upload too many videos, so that's probably why I didn't get too many comments, but there are a good number of comments that I found to be interesting enough to highlight them on this video. It's been a pretty autobiographical week for me, and I talked about my life a lot this week on my YouTube. Namely, the video which is questions a younger me would ask myself. That's kind of an entirely autobiographical project, and it's one of the videos where I put a lot of effort into it. The most effort I put into a YouTube video in recent past. I actually wrote a script, and I edited it. I mean, that just those two facts alone make it quite different from many other YouTube videos in which I just get in front of my MacBook camera and I just kind of just blabber on about whatever, just like what I'm doing right now. So anyways, these are some of the comments I received. The first comment comes from Sarah Bella, and she actually commented a lot on different sort of my videos, but always about Christianity. I think Sarah Bella is a devoted Christian, and of course this week I have a lot of videos in which I talk about my atheism and the Bible and all that, so a lot of comments are going to be related in that. So this is her comment from my video in which I read aloud Genesis chapter 1 through 2. When we had this back and forth conversation, Cerebellum, and I'm assuming it's a female because the name Cerebellum, she suggests that I skip reading the Old Testament and go right to reading the New Testament. And so we have this back and forth conversation, and I ultimately ask her, is the Old Testament irrelevant to you as a Christian? It's kind of a rhetorical question, but I really do like her response to this question. So she makes two comments in response, and this is her response. Cerebellum states, "Of course it is not irrelevant. We learn a lot from the Old Testament. Some of the songs and psalms are regularly sung in Christian worship services. The prophecies of Jesus coming are very important to us. Understanding Judaism so we better understand Jesus' life, sacrifice, and surroundings is critical. Many events in his life, e.g. Passover Supper, can only be understood by knowing the Old Testament. Many Old Testament characters like Jonah, Adam, Elijah, David, Moses, Abraham are all mentioned in the New Testament, and only by reading the Old Testament can we get a complete sense of what is meant. Jesus says, has a new covenant with us. It is only by reading about the old covenant that God had with Israel can we really understand that commitment. But until you understand who Jesus is, all of those prophecies, culture, and background won't matter very much. That's why I read the New Testament first if I was looking at Christianity. I disagree with the conclusion that you should read the New Testament first because of that. But, you know, we both agree that when we're trying to look at the Bible, Old Testament is relevant. It is important to read. And that's why I'm actually just going to stick to doing what I've been doing, reading the Bible from the canonized order that the First Catholic Church canonized, which is Genesis, Exodus, Leviticus, Numbers, Judges, going all the way that in that order to Revelation. So that's what I plan to do. Also, because I'm having a more structure to my YouTube channel, I do plan for my videos in which I read the Bible or anything about religion or atheism or Christianity or anything to that matter relevant to that topic, I'm going to be posting every Sunday. So every Sunday, I will be posting videos regarding the topics of religion, Christianity, and atheism. Next comment comes from Juzu Media Zone. On the video, questions a younger me would ask myself. And Juju Media Zone and I shared a lot of back and forth YouTube comments, but these two comments I want to highlight. We have this really long discussion on the just, you know, if heaven and hell are just or not. I consider them to be unjust. And so this was Juju Media Zone's response to that. How could God deal with evil then if those elements, and those elements being heaven or hell, are considered unjust? How would you deal with evil? There would be no need for justice then if, heaven forbid, those examples are not considered justified. This is a very odd conclusion to me. The conclusion is that if heaven and hell are considered unjust, then there is no need for justice in the human world. So if heaven and hell doesn't exist, we don't need justice. That's the ultimate conclusion here, which I think is very problematic. But anyway, that's an interesting comment that Juju Media Zone makes. Another comment Juju Media Zone makes is, after I made this kind of a tongue-in-cheek rhetorical comment about, well, you know, how would God deal with evil? Well, God should take some lessons from the human court systems, which I know is blasphemous and kind of offensive, but that's the tongue-in-cheek. Good coffee. That's the tongue-in-cheek comment that I make, simply because I think the concept that we have, as flawed as it is, you know, our human justice system is more just and more fair than the concept of heaven or hell. And Juju Media Zone believes that heaven and hell is better or perfect because God doesn't make mistakes and human court justice system does make mistakes sometimes, a lot of times actually. So this is, again, another response. Juju Media Zone states, yes, God doesn't make mistakes. Our court system has, does, and always will. Now, if you want to give me an example of what you think is just, I'll let you take back your previous comment. The previous comment being that the fact that I said, well, God should take lessons from human justice system. Go ahead, give the world an example of the ultimate just system by which our society should measure up to. So that's the response that Juju Media Zone makes, that God doesn't make mistakes at all, that God's system is perfect. Which, again, I said, my comment has been, if heaven and hell could be considered unjust, in which case it's not perfect. And does God make mistakes or not? To be a Christian, you have to believe that God doesn't. But of course, me, as I'm reading through the Bible with you guys on my Bible videos, you'll see, at least in my opinion, God does make mistakes. God even says so himself in Genesis, about Noah's Ark story. You know, God repents, or in the King James Version, it says God had repentance that he created mankind in the world. Or in the New International Version, it says God regrets making humankind. If you take that into good context, that means God considers creating mankind as a mistake. So that's one example there. But this whole notion of, you know, it's not considered just if it's able to make mistakes, is the concept that Juju Media Zone brings up, which I find to be ultimately very problematic, but I'm not going to delve too much into that. Let's go into the next comment. Next comment comes from N7Normandy1 on my video, Response to My 13-Year-Old Self. Now, N7Normandy1 comments a lot of my videos, and it seems like he watches a lot of my videos, and we also share really great conversations via personal messages. So I just want to say, N7Normandy1, I appreciate you watching my videos, appreciate you commenting on a lot of my videos. It's really awesome to have kind of what I can consider as a fan, maybe. So pretty cool, pretty awesome, thanks a lot. This video, I talked about how my experience with Metal Gear Solid, the game, when I was 13 years old, kind of inspired me to write a 200-page novel. So it's an account of how my personal experience with the video game sparked my creativity. And N7Normandy1 responses, really interesting. A year ago, when I was 14, after playing Mass Effect 2, the drama blew me away and I loved it so much, I was thinking of writing my own Mass Effect comic book series. I didn't do it, and instead I have started writing a book inspired by Dragon Age and Dark Souls. Too much like Dragon Age, which is frustrating, but I have unique characters. I'm still thinking of the Mass Effect comic book, though. So, really awesome that how video games can spark our creativity in that way. Next comment comes from Rexify in my video, Response to My 15-Year-Old Self. Again, this is a video where I talk about religion and my path to atheism, and my struggle to becoming an atheist. So Rexify comments, I understand your struggle, but is it logical to say just because hell exists and you don't like that fact, you're going to try wish God away? I don't like law enforcers, so I'm going to say police don't exist. Sounds a bit illogical. I replied to this comment in that video, of course, saying that, yeah, if that's the analogy you're using, if that's the kind of the thought process you have, yeah, of course, it's illogical. My struggle to becoming an atheism didn't start on the question like, oh, hell sucks, so I'm going to wish it away and believe that it doesn't exist. That wasn't my line of thinking. My line of thinking was this question, and this ultimate question is what started me on the path towards atheism. And the question is, the basic question is this, I ended up having much more complex and convoluted questions after this basic question. But the basic question is this. If, you know, how is it fair? How is it considered just that a person commits a finite number of deeds, good deeds or crimes, and from those countable number of good deeds and countable number of sins, how is it fair that a person can be judged from that and be punished or rewarded for an infinite amount of time? How is that just? How is it just that a person who has done mostly good deeds in his life, but because Romans says that, Romans 3:16, I forget the Bible verse, says that all men are have fallen and are guilty of sin, no matter how many good deeds you have done, just that finite number of sins will damn you to hell if you don't believe in Jesus Christ, according to Christianity. At the same time, a person who has committed a finite number of sins, such as, I don't know, murdering 20 people. So 20 murders, pretty finite number of sins. That person later in life gives up, repents, accepts Jesus Christ as a savior, and has a finite number of good deeds. Just from that, he gets to spend an infinite amount of time in heaven. The question is, how can we consider this a just system? How can we justify it? How can we justify heaven and hell? That is the question that led me to atheism, because after that came even more questions and more answers and more questions, and ultimately I just kind of threw up my hand and it's just like, this is very problematic. So until you are able to answer that question that matches my moral compass in a way that, you know, it doesn't violate my modern moral compass, that's the question that needs to be answered for me to consider the morality of Christianity. Now, okay, so next comment comes from Cerebellum on my video, in which I read from Genesis chapter 5 through 6. So, really cool that Cerebellum comments a lot on my religious videos about religion and the Bible. Cerebellum comments, most Christians aren't that easily offended. Cain's wife is talked about, even if her name isn't given. I think you're assuming the named son is the first son. That seems obviously incorrect. He is giving a particular lineage to get to Noah, then Abraham, etc. The Old Testament is about Israel, so it is leading up to that. Nothing implies, for example, that Canaan was the oldest son of Enosh. He was just the one in the lineage that produced Noah. The other lines died out and disappeared in the flood. Pretty good comment there. Honestly, like, it kind of misses my point on the video. My thought was that, you know, other than Eve, the Bible doesn't mention a single female's name. Maybe it kind of mentions a woman, but a name is not given until it talks about Lamech, which is like chapter 4, chapter 5 actually. It takes 5 chapters for the Bible to mention a single female, a woman name, which I thought was, you know, telling of the patriarchy, that patriarchal society that wrote the Bible. But yeah, until Lamech's wives' names are mentioned, a female person's name is not even talked about. That was the point there. I don't think I assume that the son of Cain, you know, is the first son or whatever. I don't really imply anything there. But that was just my comment that, you know, it doesn't really talk about woman that much, and doesn't really mention them. We kind of have to imply that females exist. The Bible doesn't really mention their names even. So that was my point there. I have a couple more comments I want to talk about, but I guess they'll be talked about in the next video. But the Hour of Kwonmunism will continue on.